On my left hand side.
My name is Prem Advani. I am from New Delhi, a retired senior citizen, non-Muslim. My question is that Islam, with a glorious past, should continue to be more glorious with a present time. I wish that the Muslims should give more transparency and access to what activities are being conducted from the grassroots level of madrasas and masjids and so on, so that the people should feel what is going on. The truth should be transparent. My name is Transparency. Thank you.
Somebody asked a very good question. Before I answer the question, I would just like to throw some light. The sister had asked early question, three questions. And that reminds me that my daughter, who had come last, she had said a song, "Don't talk to me about Muhammad, you know, peace be upon him." And the coordinator said, "Please pay attention to the words, what she's saying." And if you heard the words carefully, it's the seerat of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that once Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was going, he finds a companion as a stranger. She starts speaking against the Prophet. "Oh, the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is a bad person. Don't talk to me." She's telling Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that person doesn't know the person is talking to. She tells to the stranger, that person on the road, that Prophet Muhammad is bad. Don't listen to him. He causes disharmony. He teaches only about one God, blah, blah, blah. That's what my daughter was saying in that song. Later on, but she says, "Oh, you are a very good person. But I'm warning you, don't listen to that man, Muhammad. Peace be upon him. He's a rogue. Nauz billah. He's a very bad person. Nauz billah." And so on and so forth. But she says, "You are a very good person. You are so kind. You are so loving. Please, may I know your name?" Then she says, "Pardon? What did you say? Am I hearing correct? Your name is Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam?" Then she says, "Ashhadu Allah ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah." So when the traveler realizes that this person is actually Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, "I have heard from other people that he's the wrong person. This person is so good," she immediately accepts Islam. So our dear sister, when she posed so many questions again, I thought it reminds me of my daughter when she was narrating the seerah of the Prophet in that song. The person, the traveler attacking Islam, attacking the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But when she comes to know the truth, she says the Shahada. So inshallah, our dear sister also will say the Shahada. And I really ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open her heart. Our dear brother here asked a very good question. He agrees that Islam had a glorious past, but he says that there should be transparency, especially in the madrasa. Who says no? I'm for you, brother. I'm fully for you. Who says there should be no transparency? Not transparency. I want the non-Muslims to come and study in this madrasa. I'm aware, brother. I'm aware what you're talking about, the media. That the media is saying that madrasas are the schools of terrorism. Media says, not you, brother. Media. Madrasa in Arabic means a place of dars. Somewhat like a university. We can call it a school, call it a college, or call it a university. But the media portrays as though, you know, if you go to a madrasa, you'll become a terrorist. Media portrays, not you. I'm asking, number one person who has killed maximum human beings in the world is Hitler. Which madrasa did he go to? Which madrasa? Which madrasa he went to? See, today, you know, mafia, the top people in the world from Italy and all these smugglers, if you take a survey that all the smugglers, all the top people that go to the jail, if you take a survey, how many people go to madrasa? How many? A small, maybe a couple of percent. Majority go to universities. Which university? Modern university. Schools, colleges. So can I say that you should close the school? Can I say close the college of education, close BA, close BCom, close BSc? No. Because I know I have studied in the school. That school doesn't say that you should rob or you should smuggle. You should go against your country. It is they study in that school, but they are the black sheep of that school. So Hitler also may have gone to the modern education. I'm sure that the school he went to didn't teach him that he should kill 6 million Jews. So what we realize that these are black sheep. So as a whole, you know, every year in this country, there are thousands of people who are passing from madrasas. From Nadwa, from Deoband, thousands of them. So do you say that they're going and killing people? They're not at all. It is the media which portrays. And now, the government wants to go. And last year or year before last, they went to Nadwa, imagine. They went to Nadwa and they wanted a search warrant they took out to check. To check what? And Ali Mian Nadwi, Rahimullah, he said, okay, come forward, check. What they found? Nothing. See, once in a blue moon, one in a lakh, one in 100,000, one in 1,000,000, maybe a person after he passed the madrasa may have been misled. That doesn't mean madrasa teaches that. But a bigger percentage of the students studying from schools, modern education, from colleges, from university, which we get degrees of BA, BCom, engineering, doctor, more of the people doing wrong activities than evil activities. So as far as transparency, brother, I'm for it. No madrasa will ever say that you do not come and check. Our syllabus is open. In our school, we are teaching, mashallah, we are teaching comparative studies. My student from my school knows more about Hinduism than average Hindu. He knows more about Christianity than average Christian. He knows more about Islam than an average Muslim, because we pay attention to both of them. So as far as transparency, brother, is concerned, I'm for you, I'm with you, and no one will ever say that you don't come and analyze. Come, but don't blame. Don't come with a negative mind. Come with open mind. You may never know, you may get hidayah. You may come to the truth. Yes, brother.
Create an atmosphere of encouragement for non-Muslims to come and learn something and see for themselves. That is what I mean by transparency, so that people should not have suspicion that something wrong is going on, something good is going on. But you should make it transparent.
Brother asked a very good question. We should make it transparent for non-Muslim to come and study. Brother, first invitation I give to you and your children, come to IRF. I give invitation to you. See, Islamic Research Foundation has a library. It is one of the most well-equipped libraries, at least in India, of scriptures of different religions. You know, we have more than 200 different types of Bible, more than 50 versions of the Bible. We have more than 50 translations only of Bhagavad Gita. We have several translations of Vedas, of Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Atharva Veda. You may not find in the library of your government. You may not find in the library of maybe your school of thought. We encourage, study, and come to the truth. And leave aside others. I give the first invitation to you and to your children. I will even bear the air ticket free. Come to IRF and we welcome you. Study and we will learn the truth together, inshallah. Can you on the microphone? Yes, brother.
I wish to thank you that you have taken my suggestion in the right spirit, and I will take opportunity to avail of your offer.
Please, just write to us, I'll send you an air ticket, inshallah.
Yes, brother from the center mic.
My name is Ramakrishna. I am a physiotherapy student. My question is, what is the need of Allah to create Adam and Eve and this total universe? What he will get from this? And my second question is, everything is created by someone. So even God must have been created by someone. What is the meaning of Allah?
Brothers asked three questions. The first question, why did God create Adam and Eve, and what was his reason to create all this world and humankind? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam and Eve, may peace be upon them both, so that the humankind could come. They were the great, great grandparents. Allah says in Surah Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 13, Ya ayyuhan nasu inna khalaqnakum min zakrin wa unsa wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum innallaha alimun khabir. O humankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female, and I've divided you into nations and tribes so that you may recognize each other, not that you may despise each other. And the most honored in the sight of Almighty God is the person who has taqwa. The criteria to judge any human being, it is not wealth, it's not color, it's not caste, it's not creed, it is taqwa, it is God consciousness, it is righteousness, it is piety. So Adam and Eve, peace be upon them both, they were our great-great grandparents, of yours also and of mine also, all humankind. Therefore, I call you a brother. We are brothers in humanity. Allah says, Ya you are nas, O humankind. And Allah says in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 70, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَا. Almighty God has honored all the children of Adam. Whether they are born in India, USA, UK, born in a Hindu family or a Muslim family or a Christian family, Allah says He has honored all the Bani Adam. If you are a human being, Allah has honored you. Whether your name is Zakir, Abdullah, Ramu, Shankar, if you are born as a human being, Allah has honored you. Now coming to the question, why has Almighty God created the human beings? Allah has created the human beings because Allah says this is one of His best creation. All the other creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they obey Him. We have the angels. Whatever Almighty God says, the angels obey Him directly. They have no free will. The human being is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has a free will. We can either obey Him or disobey Him. So Allah has created such a creation. We are one of His best creation in the best of forms. But we have a choice of either obeying God or disobeying God. If we obey God, we will go to Jannah, we'll go to Swarg, we'll go to heaven. If we disobey Him, we'll go to hell. We'll go to Nark. So this is a test for the hereafter. Allah says in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 2, Allazi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. It is Allah who has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. So this life is a test for the hereafter. So Allah has created the human beings, and Allah says in Surah Dhariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 56, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That we have created the jinn and the men not but to worship Him. So we supposed to worship, obey the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a different creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has the free will of even going against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or obeying Him. All the other things, the stars, the trees, the mountains, the Quran says they do sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They prostrate to Him, they obey Him. We have a free will. Now, when Allah has given a free will, with the free will, if we obey Him, we become higher than the angels. With the free will, if we disobey Him, we become the partners of the devil. So He's created us for the test for the hereafter. Coming to your second question. Everything has a creator. Who created? God. If anyone says everything has a creator, it is a wrong statement. Every created thing has a creator. The definition of God is, He is uncreated. The moment you say who created God, He's not God. The definition of God is He is uncreated. Suppose a person comes and asks you, that brother, my friend John, he was admitted in the hospital. He gave birth to a child. Can you guess, was it a girl or a boy? Can you guess? Try it out. Guess? Can't guess. Why? Can you on the microphone? Can you guess, was it a girl or a boy? Huh? See, brother John, he was admitted in the hospital. He gave birth to a child. Was it a girl or a boy? Can you guess? A 50% chance? Girl or boy? People are laughing. Why? Can you guess? Can't guess. Why? Even if you guess, can you get the answer right? Can you guess? I'll give you two chances. Was it a girl or a boy? Try it out.
Girl.
Brother, can a man give birth to a child? There you made a mistake. Same way you made a mistake by asking who created God. A man cannot give birth to a child. So where's the question of it being girl or a boy? See, now you understood. Now that's good, brother. So it was, a man cannot give birth to a child, so where's the question of a girl or a boy? So when you're asking who created God, God by definition, Allah by definition is uncreated. The moment you say who created Allah, He's not Allah. وَلَمْ يَقُلْ لَهُ كُفَّانَ. There's nothing like Him. Coming to your last part of the question, who is Allah? Who is Allah? The best definition I can give you is quote to you Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4. It's mentioned in the Quran, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Say He is Allah one and only. Allah Hussamad. Allah the absolute eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not nor is He begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufwan ahad. There's nothing like Him. This is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any human being, any person says so and so candidate is God. If that candidate fits in this four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that candidate as God. Four-line definition. This is the litmus test for theology, for the study of God. First is, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Say He's Allah one and only. Allah Samad. Allah the absolute and eternal. Lam yulad wa lam yulad. He begets not nor is he begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There's nothing like him. If you go to the Hindu scriptures, the same is mentioned in the Hindu scriptures. Kul huwallahu ahad is mentioned. If you read Chandogya Upanishad, chapter number 6, section number 2, verse number 1, Ikkam Evidityam, God is only one without a second. Second test, Allah Hussamad, Allah the absolute eternal. Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 10, verse number 3 says, I am known as the Lord of all the worlds, the unbegotten, the beginningless. Third test, Lam Yulad Valam Yulad, he begets not nor is he begotten. It's mentioned in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad. Chapter number 6, verse number 9. Nachasya kasij, janita na chadipa. Of him, there are no lords. He has got no parents. Almighty God has got no father. He has got no mother. And valam yakulla ukufan ad. There's nothing like him is mentioned in Shvetashvatara Upanishad. Chapter number 4, verse number 19. And Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3, where it says, Natasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. There is no idol. There is no image. There is no photograph. There is no sculpture. Who says that? Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3. Same as Walam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad. So any person saying so and so candidate is God, if that candidate fits in the four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that candidate as God. For example, some people say Bhagwan Rajneesh is Almighty God. Once during question answer time, a Hindu told me, we don't believe Bhagwan Rajneesh to be God. I never said that the Hindus believe Bhagwan Rajneesh is God. I said some people believe Bhagwan Rajneesh to be God. Let us put this Rajneesh to test. First test is Kul Huwallahu Ahad. Say is Allah one and only. Was Rajneesh one and only? Was he the only man who claimed divinity? There are hundreds of them. And in this country, we have thousands of men who have claimed divinity. He's not the only one. But Rajneesh Bhakti said, no, he's unique. Let's go to the next test. Allahu Samad. Allah the absolute and eternal. Was Rajneesh absolute and eternal? We know from his biography, from his autobiography, he was suffering from asthma, from diabetes, from chronic backache. Imagine Almighty God suffering from asthma, diabetes, chronic backache. Third test, Lam Yulad Valam Yulad. He begets not nor is begotten. Bhagwan Rajneesh was born in Madhya Pradesh. He had a father and mother. In 1981, he goes to America, USA, and he takes thousands of Americans for a ride. In the state of Oregon, he starts his center and calls it as Rajneeshpuram, his village. Later on, the American government arrests him and put him behind bar. Rajneesh says, the American government slow poisoned me. Imagine Almighty God being slow poisoned. In 1985, the American government kick him out of the country. He comes back to India in the same city, Pune, and he goes back to his center, which is now called as Osho Commune. And if you go to the Samadhi of Rajneesh, it is mentioned there on the Samadhi, Bhagwan Rajneesh, Osho, never born, never died, but visited the earth from the 11th of December 1931 to the 19th of January 1990. Never born, never died, but visited the earth from the 11th of December 1931 to the 19th of January 1990. They forgot to mention his Samadhi. He was not given visas to 21 countries of the world. Almighty God coming in this world to visit the world and requires visas to go to different countries. And the Archbishop of Greece said, if you don't remove Rajneesh out of this country, we'll burn his house and the house of his disciples. And the last test, Valam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad, is so stringent that no one besides the true Almighty God can pass. The moment you can compare God to anything, he's not God. Valam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad. We know Rajneesh, like the human beings, had a beard, one nose, two eyes, two ears, two hands. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, he's not God. Valam Yakul Lahu Kufuwan Ahad. If someone says Almighty God is 1,000 times stronger than Arnold Schwarzenegger. Might have heard the name of Arnold Schwarzenegger. Have you heard Arnold Schwarzenegger? The person who got the title Mr. World, Mr. Universe. The strongest man in the world, the strongest man in the universe. The moment you can compare God to anyone, whether it be Arnold Schwarzenegger, whether it be Dara Singh, whether it be King Kong, whether it be 1,000 times or 1,000,000 times. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, he is not God. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There's nothing like him. So this is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given in the Quran. Whichever God you're worshipping, brother, put that God to the test of Surah Ikhlas. If that God passes, that is a true God. Otherwise, it's a fake God.
Let us have a question from the sister's side, please. A non-Muslim sister should come forward and ask a question, please.
आदाब डॉक्टर जायकन्या साहब, मेरा नाम वेंकटम्मा है। मैं एक मुस्लिम लेडी सादिया मैडम के पास रहती हूँ कई सालों से। मेरा सवाल है, आप बोलते हैं कोई भी मज़हब गलत चीज़ नहीं बताता, गलत काम करने के लिए उत्सुक नहीं करता, और आप क्या वजह है जिसकी वजह से इस्लाम कबूल करने के लिए बोलते हैं तमाम मुस्लिम?
Sister asked the question that she lives with a Muslim for several years. When I said that all the religions speak good things, then why do the Muslims ask me to accept Islam? Point number one. I say that all the religions, most of the things they say are good. But Islam, besides speaking good things, shows you a way how to achieve that goodness. And I give the example, all religions say don't rob. Islam says the same, but Islam shows you a way how to achieve a state in which people will not rob. Give zakat, give charity. After that, someone robs, chop off the hand, there will be no robbery, there will be no crime. So in this way, I try to explain that Islam, besides talking about good things, shows you a way how to achieve that state of goodness. Secondly, if I have to say, being a student of comparative religion, if you have to follow your Hindu scriptures, assuming you're a Hindu, if you have to follow your Hindu scriptures, if you have to be a good Hindu, your Hindu scriptures say, there is one God. I quoted all these verses in my previous answer. One God. Your scripture says don't do idol worship. Bhagavad Gita chapter number 7 verse number 20. All those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires, they worship demigods. They do idol worship. You have to believe in one God. I said in my lecture today that you have to believe in the Antim Rishi, the Kalki Avatar, whose father's name will be Vishnu Yash Abdullah. Mother's name shall be Sumati Amina, who will be born in the village of Sambala, Makkah. Who will be born with the chief of the village of Sambala, chief of Makkah. He will be a messenger for the whole of humankind. He will get enlightenment at night in a cave. He will go northwards and come back. He will be given 8 qualities. He will be a messenger for the whole of humankind. He will ride a horse. He will have a sword in the right hand. He will have 4 companions. He will be helped by the angels and devatas. On and on and on. Who is this person? If you are a good Hindu, you have to believe in the Antim Rishi. Otherwise, you are not a good Hindu. If you are a good Hindu, you have to believe in one God. You don't have to do idol worship. Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no Pratima. There is no idol. There is no image. There is no photograph. There is no sculpture. And I have had dialogues with pandits of Hinduism. Vishankaracharya. Many. And I've quoted this. No Shankaracharya told me, Brother Zakir, you're wrong. No one. I had a dialogue with Sri Sri Ravi Shankar on 21st of January, supposed to be the most popular spiritual guru, Art of Living. I told him, the best book on Art of Living is the glorious Quran. I asked him to join our club of Art of Living. We have 1.3 billion members. 1.3 billion members. I gave him an invitation. If he follows the scriptures, he's supposed to be a scholar of the Vedas, he should come to this. Similarly, sister, when I say that all the other scriptures, even if you agree with the word of God, by the passage of time, they have been changed. Swami Vivekananda says that 99% of the Vedas have been lost. Whatever 1% we have to follow it strictly. Strictly means believe in Antim Rishi also. So if you follow it strictly, you'll have to believe in Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, have to believe in the Quran, and I give you an invitation, sister, to come to this religion of peace so that you can come closer to Almighty God. Question.